This episode is sponsored by State Farm. Choices are great. Like with your podcasts, you get to choose what you want to listen to. And State Farm believes insurance should work the same way. That's why the State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you get the coverage you want at an affordable price and a policy that helps cover what you value most. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. Call or go to statefarm.com today to create your State Farm Personal Price Plan. Prices vary by state. Options selected by customer. Availability and eligibility may vary.
As if the McCrispy couldn't get any better, Bacon and Ranch just entered the chat. The Bacon Ranch McCrispy, available at participating McDonald's for a limited time. Ba-da-ba-ba-ba.
The Purple Mafia, with your host, Paladino Joey.
Well, we'll see. The doctors would disagree, but what do they know?
So let's just say that you'll pay me because it's in your interest to pay me.
Is it worth it? I mean, you've won. Do you want to wipe everybody out?
I don't feel I have to wipe everybody out, Tom. Just my enemies. That's all. My father taught me many things.
He taught me, keep your friends close, but your enemies closer.
These are wonderful things that we've achieved. And there's no limit to where we can go from here.
Welcome to the family here on Purple Mafia, as once again we are ready to talk some Vikings football. Here on thesportstuff.com and on iTunes. It is episode number 37 of Purple Mafia, so we are moving right along here very rapidly, show after show after show. And, well, my voice is finally back up to speed, finally. So no more of the cracking voice from a summer cold. You know, that's an oxymoron, summer cold. Pretty ridiculous. There was a little cracking in Favre's game, unfortunately, as we're going to talk about the Vikings and Kansas City Chiefs preseason game today. That'll be the main focus of the show today. Brett Favre's performance, Tarvaras Jackson, of course, Sage Rosenfels didn't play, Shanko emerging, lots of stuff to get to. So other than that, real quick, we're available on thesportstuff.com, as I mentioned. Do go to thesportstuff.com. On the right-hand side, there's a button that says TSS Boards. That is how you can sign up for the message boards. It is 100% free and 100% fun. That's how you can interact with our podcasters, other members, almost 400 of us now. You can also vote on the polls in the podcast section. Click on Purple Mafias. There will be a poll today. I'll get to that at the end of the show. Regarding Brett Favre, of course, what a surprise. So other than that, we do have a call-in line on thesportstuff.com. It is a voicemail. Treat it as such. The number is 209-736-7TSS, 209-736-7877, if you don't want to look at what TSS stands for, but yep, that is the deal. Treat it as such. Mention you are calling in for Purple Mafia. State your opinion, your question, your comment, your shout-out, whatever it is. That is how you can get on the show and hear your voice with mine. So there you go. It's like being a guest, basically. Other than that, we're going to take a break again, and we'll be right back after these announcements.
Here on thesportstuff.com, the new fast-breaking wolves are bursting on the scene with Timberwolves Explosion. Hear about this exciting new era with Al Jefferson, Kevin Love, Johnny Flynn, and new coach Kurt Rambis. Check us out on thesportstuff.com and on iTunes, where we cover the Wolves like nobody else. Show your true blue, download and listen to this explosion of Timberwolves basketball.
Here on thesportstuff.com, we're toughing up on Brave the Wild with Paladino. Join me, Paladino, as we brave the Minnesota Wild Hockey Club on our way to the playoffs. We're available on thesportstuff.com and iTunes. The boogeyman, Derek Bugard, says you'd better listen or he just might drop the gloves. Call up your courage and brave the wild with your buddy, Paladino Joey.
And we are back here on Purple Mafia, episode number 37. A reminder for iPod users. All right, thank you for bearing with me through the break once again, like always. Do check out those shows. But yeah, anyhow, we're getting on to the game now. The Vikings, of course, win 17-13. But it's not about wins and losses. It's about performance. It's about shaking the rust off. Brett Favre, a lot of us expected just a little bit of rust. Remember he mentioned he didn't even really work out that much this offseason, unlike previous off seasons, as he thought he really was retired, especially after the whole rotator cuff issue. He was like, oh boy, I might be done here. And of course, back in March and stuff, he thought he was done, I'm sure. Brett Favre comes in the game and was 1-for-4 overall, 4 yards. The first ever completion, and only a completion so far for Brett Favre as a Viking, was to the other guy, the other man of the hour, Percy Harvin, who showed definitely that this guy definitely has hands, that's for sure. He definitely has good hands, and that's what counts. Harvin overall, in terms of receiving, finished with 2 catches and 9 yards. So they were just both short passes. So maybe Percy Harvin will be a possession receiver after all. Who knows? But yeah, you expect a lot of short passes to go to Percy Harvin, because the whole idea is him catch the ball and then take off on those screen passes. Take off and go for, who knows, 30, 40, 50, 70 yards, whatever. So I'll be going into a really long completion in a little bit. A guy who emerged and might be inching closer to a job on this Minnesota Vikings team. He might be a dark horse winner at the receiver position. We'll get into that shortly. As Brett Favre, that was pretty much all there was to it. As after the game, Favre said that he felt butterflies, which is something he said he hadn't felt in a long time. And that's always a plus, Brett Favre said, that it's always a plus. There's, you know, that means it just shows how much he wanted to be here. And also how, you know, it felt really weird. Really weird being on the other side. I mean, you're walking in the Metrodome as a player, not as an opponent, you know, as a member of the team, not as an opponent. Very crazy, very strange, but at the same time, very cool. To me, what I saw from Favre, the positive, the ball really comes out of his hand quickly, and the velocity on his passes, pretty darn good. I mean, that is some serious velocity. Obviously, things aren't going to be all spectacular right off the bat in the first game. Even though he knows the West Coast offense, he's practiced with these guys, you know, and knows their tendencies about as much as I know them. You know, I mean, you know, as much as I'd know them if I walked on the field, you know, or as much as I'd know maybe the Cincinnati Bengals if I just walked on the field, basically. You know, I mean, I wouldn't know right off the bat where they're going to go on every play. You know, it's just the way it goes. You know, even just like in basketball, my buddy Dave, you know, when we first started playing basketball together, we went the wrong way. We'd bump into each other. We'd throw the ball out of bounds, you know, stuff like that. That's just how it goes. Overall, though, the important part is when you see the velocity on those passes, that's what counts right now. And also the way Brett Favre, being hit a few times pretty hard, just jumped right back up, just kind of shook his head going, all right, yeah, that's cool. And Favre also mentioned after the game, That's big. You know, that's good, you know, getting hit a few times and feeling good about it. You know, that he not necessarily wanted to get hit, but that it felt good to get that out of the way. The first couple hits, so you can get kind of used to it again. You know, it's just getting your feet wet again, because he wasn't really expecting to play this season. He just wasn't at one point. So that is the good part. Another guy, well, as now we're going to get into his topic here, the man of the night. The unexpected man of the night, the guy you thought might fold and not give a dang anymore, but ultimately, the guy who might be showcasing himself for his next team, Tarvaras Jackson, stepped up to the plate in a very nice way. He did make one mistake, as I'll mention this early on, just to get it out of the way. So I'm going to be a negative jerk here on him, just because I can. Yeah, he completed a 43-yard pass to Jamar Johnson, and it looked like a nice play, but unfortunately, he was just a little past the line of scrimmage. Just a little bit there, Tarvaras. Just a little bit there past that line of scrimmage there. You might want to work on that. Tarvaras, as Brett would say. So that got called back, and it was just like, that figures, basically. But then Tarvaras Jackson continued to play extremely good football, finished with a perfect quarterback rating of 158.3, 202 yards, completed 80% of his passes, 12 of 18, or 15, excuse me, overall. That's outstanding. Had a couple of long completions also, unlike Sage Rosenfels and Jackson last week. And, of course, Booty is incapable of completing a long pass right now. Two touchdowns and no interceptions for Tarvaras, who might be a Cincinnati Bengal. He might be a Jacksonville Jaguar, where he'll join a emerging Troy Williamson. That was kind of disgusting to hear. Troy Williamson is emerging with the Jacksonville Jaguars. Might be their number two or number one receiver, because apparently Torrey Holt is done, basically. That he's got really much no tread left on the tire. That's the guy I wanted on the Vikings at receiver at one point in time. Yeah, that is one thing. A receiver who's got plenty of tread left on his tire, Dwayne Bowe, looked pretty good. That's a Kansas City wide receiver. Of course, Kansas City Chiefs are Farzine's club. Farzine Vasugian of the Chiefs Zone on the sportsstuff.com on iTunes. There's a shout-out to him, and his show is outstanding. And he's just outstanding. An outstanding talent is Farzine for someone his age. He is really stepping up to the plate. I like the youngster, Dwayne Bowe, who's in his junior season, you could say. He had a great rookie year, was finished second to Adrian Peterson for Offensive Rookie of the Year, and had a horrible sophomore year, unfortunately, but I could definitely see him stepping it up. Matt Castle was solid. Nothing spectacular, but solid. 9 of 14 for 99 yards was Matt Castle. So there's your quarterback comparison, Tarvaras Jackson, Brett Favre versus Matt Castle. Brody Croyle and Gutierrez, nothing much to see, really. They're just a couple of John David Booties, basically. At this point in time, Brody Croyle is a guy who at one point in time they saw as some type of quarterback of the future in KC. Not looking good. One other quick thing I'll make of note to end the whole quarterback deal in Kansas City. Tyler Thigpen didn't even see the field. And he looked like a baby Rich Gannon last year. Me and Farzine would agree about that, as we talk all the time about it, about our teams and just about sports in general. He looked pretty good last year, Tyler Thigpen, the former Vikings 7th-round pick, who wound up with the Chiefs. Didn't even see the field, so I'm not sure what's going on there, if there's some type of chemistry issue with the coaching or an injury that they're not reporting. Because, Farzine doesn't know what happened to him. None of us know what happened to him. We don't know what's going on. Very strange. Very strange deal there. So now, on to the receivers for the game. My goodness, does Vasante Shenko, he really does look like a stud. And I stand by my prediction that Vasante Shenko is going to lead the team in receptions. There's no doubt about it. Tied with Darius Reynaud, who I'm about to get into very shortly. Vasante Shenko made a catch for a touchdown. He only made two catches, but, you didn't play that much. Very good, Vasante Shenko. He just gets the job done, and that's what counts. Lots of debate on the touchdown pass, if it really was a great play by Jackson, or if it was behind him, It looked like a decent play, but could have been better, basically. But ultimately, I think it was Vasante Shenko who pulled the pass in more than Tarvaras Jackson made a great play. I'm giving more credit to Vasante at this point in time as Glue Hands Shenko, who used to be Brick Hands Shenko. This guy has just made a complete transformation, and I recommend him for your fantasy teams out there if you're looking for a sleeper. Some of you out there that might not be from Minnesota and don't really pay super close attention, and you're like a new listener. Yeah, that's a guy I'd look at. So we're going to get on also. Darius Reynaud was able to bring in a 64-yard touchdown from Tarvaras Jackson. Both players making each other look better on that play. Just outstanding. Both of them boosting their stats for the night. Darius Reynaud, right now, folks, the guy Jamar Johnson that I was all excited about, it's starting to look like Reynaud might be getting the early advantage, just a slight advantage over Jamar. At least in these two games, Darius Reynaud has taken the upper hand thus far. So a very interesting Just a very interesting antidote there. I mean, I didn't expect it. Sidney Rice was solid. Was able to bring in 3 catches for 32 yards. Very solid. As I said, looks a lot bigger this year. Ian Johnson with 2 catches out of the backfield. He looks all right. Another major thing, though, now that we kind of slide into running backs, Peterson looked decent. And, with 10 rushes in the game, I was kind of surprised he got that many. Lots of handoffs for Favre in the early going. As, 10 rushes, 44 yards for Adrian. Solid, nothing spectacular, and he doesn't have to be spectacular. That's all that really matters. Neither Ian Johnson or Albert Young looked fantastic on the ground. Albert Young was a little bit better overall. I mean, the only running back that really did anything in the game was Adrian. But the running game was kind of quiet in this night. Both teams have pretty solid defensive lines at this point in time. Obviously, ours is pretty darn good, I would say. Larry Johnson didn't hardly do anything. Battle didn't do anything. Lawrence, not much running game tonight on this particular evening. Well, last night, I'll say. But I'll say that particular evening. Albert Young, though, again, is getting the upper hand because he put a few nice hits on special teams, and he's improving in an area that was a major weakness for him last season. You could argue that's why Albert Young did not make the active roster last year. He luckily was good enough to be on the practice squad. It's further solidifying Young's spot on Sundays, man. Albert Young is, now that he can start to play on special teams, they can start to count on him on special teams. They were comparing him to Harold Morrow. That guy was outstanding. Oh, he was a backup running back. He was a outstanding special teams player, tackler. I'm very happy with Albert Young. I think this guy absolutely is going to be on this team. Albert Young, just very, very cool what I'm seeing out of Albert Young. Other than that, overall, as we're going to slide over to defense now, the defense, 3 sacks in the game. Benny Sapp was able to sneak in and get a sack on his old club. That was really cool to see. Fred Evans with his 2nd sack of the preseason. Fred Evans, at least, being productive in the limited time he gets. And that's not bad at all. Great to see. Great to see Mitchell getting a sack as well. Jamie Mitchell able to get a sack in the game. Though they were the only tackles the guys were able to get. Sapp, Mitchell, and Fred Evans. But, Fred Evans with 2 sacks so far in the preseason. That's very encouraging as he's been a solid backup for the Vikings for the last couple of years. Nothing amazing. Asher Allen continuing to show he absolutely is going to be the nickelback. I can't see that enough. Guys that really stepped up in this game, though, that kind of surprised me a bit. Walker, who is just a training camp inventee, looking pretty good with 3 tackles in the game. Not bad at all. Burnett? How about that? Burnett, the defensive lineman, stepping in with 3 tackles as well. He had a pretty solid game. Burnett, I was very, very happy with what I saw from him, providing some energy for this team. But Jasper Brinkley? Holy moly, as I was saying last week, this guy clearly stepping up on special teams and in the regular play. Absolutely, this guy is emerging. He might be a steal, folks, at that fifth round. Jasper Brinkley looking fantastic, leading the team in tackles. And again, I can't say enough about this guy. I absolutely love him. Oh, and by the way, real quick, Brian Robison is back before I get to the other guy. Brian Robison back already, so the whole ankle thing with him looks to be okay. He's able to get 2 tackles in the game. He's a nice energy guy for this team. He gets sacks, gets tackles. He's got that quote-unquote motor, as people like to say. By the way, Burnett also got a fumble recovery in the game. He's starting to turn some heads a little bit. 2nd week in a row, he's been a pretty nice factor. He got a sack last week, don't forget. As my voice is starting to crack again, I apologize. I guess I'm not 100% recovered yet. But now the other guy, again, as I talk about him all the time, I love him, LaTroy Guyon, again, productive in the time that he gets to play. When you put LaTroy Guyon on the field, he does his job, and he does it well. He really does a good job. Two tackles for a LaTroy Guyon in the game. And, again, providing that energy. No sacks so far for LaTroy in the preseason, but he's been making the tackles, at least. Just a productive defensive lineman. Very happy with what I see. Pretty much a guy who'll kill those running backs. And that's good. You know, no running game at all. And you got the Williams wall, and you got guys like Guyon backing him up. I'm very pleased with what I'm seeing. Jared Allen, unfortunately, unable to play as ankle injury for Jared Allen. Unfortunate. The guy played through a knee injury last year and shoulder problems the whole year, or at least for most of the year, the second half of the season at least. And also getting hit by Godster Sherrillis of the Detroit Lions. I love saying that name. One of the coolest names ever. Jared Allen was able to play through that and get two sacks after that. Yeah, when Jared Allen is sitting out, man, that's not good. So let's fold our hands and pray that this guy is okay. He is a defensive MVP type of talent, is Jared Allen, number 69. Guy is an amazing talent, and man, we just got to hope and pray that if it's a high ankle sprain, which it could be, just hope that thing is close to 100% by regular season. That's just a bummer, man. Hope and pray for the best. We all remember Randy Moss as a rookie hurt his ankle and went out and had 17 touchdowns and about 1,300 yards. So it doesn't always kill players. Sometimes they come back and get it done anyway. So we're just going to have to see with that. We are just going to have to see with that when it comes to Jared Allen. As I'll now stop repeating myself about him. Just a solid game by the Vikings. They're able to kind of come back and take care of business. It's not about wins and losses, but the performances are there. Also, as I forgot to mention, of course, Sage Rosenfels out with an ankle injury as well. May have been part of the reason the Vikings looked at Brett Favre again, and also the play of Jackson and Sage Rosenfels. So unbelievably inconsistent. Brett Favre, you know, a better option no matter what anyway. But it was going into the season with some problems, injury problems already to Sage. Already couldn't play in a game. So we're just going to have to wait and see. It's funny, though, how well Sage looked in the first game, like solid. And Jackson looked elite last night. But, of course, Tarvaras Jackson, you take any good game he plays with a grain of salt because you just never know when he's just like the kind of stock you watch on the stock market that goes up and down, up and down. You just don't know. You don't know. You know, you enjoy the run, but you don't make a long investment in Tarvaras Jackson. You short him. You know, you short him. When his stock is up, you short that stock in a hurry. So, because it's going to drop. So, no offense to him or anybody that's his fan. I'm sorry. You know, history repeats itself, and it's repeated itself one too many times with Uncle Tarvaras. I think he's on his way out in some type of trade this week, and I wouldn't mind that, I guess. I mean, I'll wish him the best. I have nothing against the guy. He's the guy who's got some talent. He's definitely got talent, but just don't know. He just can't seem to put together a long string of good football. If he ever could, he'd be a starter in this NFL. Because the talent is there, but if the consistency is not, that's what's missing. Plain and simple, end of sermon. And that will also end the game review part of this show, as we're getting close to wrapping her up, mercifully for some of you out there. All right, anyhow, just trying to be modest, I guess. Well, we have a poll on thesportstuff.com. As mentioned, get on those message boards, click on the podcaster section, and click on Purple Mafia. The poll is, how will Favre fare this year? There are four choices. One is amazing, just like the old days, Vikings are in business. Two, decent, enough to be a factor. Three, mediocre, not much better than Sage or Jackson. Or four, bad. Big mistake by Favre and the Vikings. And please do vote on one of the four. And if you could, leave a comment on there as to why you made your vote, your reasoning behind it, and it'll be read on air. I'll make my vote here really quick. It is decent enough to be a factor, because I can't just go up there and say amazing just like the old days. I can't say that just yet. Some of you out there might say that. Maybe you saw something. Maybe you believe that, he is on his way to doing that, and he could be if that torn bicep tendon getting fixed up a bit, getting detached, is the answer to Favre's return to greatness. I'm going to say decent enough to be a factor because I think he's going to be a big factor for this team. That is how I'm going to stand at this point in time. I also want to close here by saying a thank you to you fans out there. All you new listeners, I want to welcome you to the family of Purple Mafia. Thank you very much for joining this podcast, because I know there are a lot of new listeners out there. It's plain as day, Purple Mafia has exploded. And it was already on a very nice uptrend the last 3 weeks. I mean, I've been watching it closely. There's been a nice uptrend, and I just thank all of you for hopping on board, and for some of you may have told your friends out there, some of you loyal listeners that have been around about a year, thank you, and continue to tell your friends, and new listeners, tell your friends as well. It is just great to have you on board. It's fantastic. And, of course, Brett Favre has really brought in a lot of new listeners, and I want to thank Brett Favre personally. If for whatever reason he's bored and happens onto this podcast, I don't think he listens to the media much, but if you know, you ever feel like Favre happens to be listening, thank you for creating some buzz in this town and for helping this show really, really explode. I mean, I'm thrilled. It has been a blast this past week or so. Thank you for that, Brett. As of Tuesday morning. I'll mention one last time, the call-in number on the sportsstuff.com is 209-7367-TSS, 209-7367-877. Do treat it as a voicemail. Mention that you're calling for Purple Mafia, and of course, make your statement, question, shout out, whatever it is. Welcome on board. You will be played on air, and it'll be a pleasure to have you on board the Viking ship here on Purple Mafia. Also, if you'd like to follow my Twitter account, it is twitter.com/PaladinoLive, twitter.com/PaladinoLive, and also PaladinoLive@yahoo.com, PaladinoLive@yahoo.com. Leave your name in town, as Bill O'Reilly would say, and then make your statement or whatever it is, statement, question, complaint, whatever. It'd be great to have you on board. And also, please rate me on iTunes. I'd appreciate it. Rate me and leave a comment on there. I could use more ratings on there. People haven't been putting reviews on there. Heck, even if it's negative, go right ahead. Bring it on. Let's see what you got. So, all right, let's put an end to this. Thank you for listening, guys. And we'll be back to talk about the Houston Texans game. Will Sage Rosenfels get to play against his old team? Will he be able to go out there and kick their butts for trading him? How dare they? So we'll see what happens there, and we'll talk to you then.